Nice to meet you this afternoon. So today I will talk how I built Barrel. I started to build Barrel from scratch, which is kind of big work. I wouldn't have guessed that it would take more than 1 year to do that. But let's start to talk about what is Barrel, and we will then see the constraints. Sorry. Okay. So we'll talk about the constraint that you have to when you want to build a database in Erlang, and then how I did it in Erlang. So first, just to quickly introduce myself, I'm Benoît Chesneau. I'm living in France. I'm French. I'm a craftsman working on peer-to-peer technology and database data endpoint. I would say endpoint because the most of the time I'm working on customizing some database or the usage of some database inside some services. Could be Erlang services or Python services. I'm just doing open source since I started to work, since now more than 20 years. And my corporate interface is Enki Multimedia. So why Barrel? Because I think there is a need for versatile data points, because most of people today, what they are doing, they are building microservices. They are starting to figure out how they can expose their data to the microservices. Today you have GraphQL, you have Falco, you have things like this, but they are still just interface programmable interface that you need to write, and you need to write the interface to the database endpoint. Could be Postgres, could be any other database. So I figured that we needed, and that I needed, at least for me, to have a simple way to just put my data and do something with that. Like when you see a lot of people doing today, like LinkedIn or others, they are using Kafka. They are first putting their data in Kafka to make sure they can query reuse them again later. And they are using the data from Kafka and putting them later in a database. Could be MySQL, could be something custom, etc., etc. And Barrel is just about that. This is first a logs. We put the data under a document, like we will see, and we are able to query that in time, to query back in time, to replicate back in time, and to do filtered logs. So we are in the contrary to Kafka, where you just have to read all the data from the scratch or from a point, and you have to pass that inside the filter. In Barrel, you just have to take that filter. It's already indexed. Your data is already indexed inside, and you get that in time. So Barrel is a modern database. This is you storing documents with a time, the time the moment you are storing documents in the database. And attachments, and think attachments just like attachments in your mail. So if you want to attach blobs or anything else, an Erlang data, for example, to your documents, then you make an attachment to your database, and it's also indexed. It's distributed, but first, this is local first. By local first, we will see what it means. But in short, it means that most of the time what you want is to have a subset of your data near your application so you can use it in your application very fast. This is why everyone is fighting with the cache these days. Why not just ditching that cache? And this is automatic indexing, so you don't have to care about creating key value views, function, or whatever. It's indexing everything in your database. And I'm focusing on simplicity, so you don't have any large query language, etc. It's just focusing on filterings, loggings, replicating your data and there to you or between the different nodes. This is peer-to-peer, so you have master-master replication in both ways. You can only replicate a subset of your data. If you want to, you don't have to. So if you have a large database of terabytes, you obviously don't want a terabyte of data on your on mobile phones or on your laptop. So you can just say, I just want to replicate that subset I will use during my trip or during the calculation I need to. And it works in both ways. So you can also update locally your data and replicate later to your data store. So you always replicate a partial view of your data and into a very mean stat part. So we can imagine to have a chain of nodes. So we start with nodes, we start to embed Barrel in your database, which is the first level on top. You embed that Barrel nodes inside your applications, start to replicate from the another nodes, doing query. You want to get all the data corresponding to that user at that moment in your application, so you replicate that data to your applications. And if it's not on that node, it can query the node on the bottom to get to fetch that data back. So you really get a partial view, and you can chain that queries systems. And this is agnostic indexing. So we are storing documents, and documents are map in Erlang, JSON for the other transport. And if you imagine JSON or maps, a JSON is just a tree. So what we are indexing in Barrel is a graph. We are indexing, you are splitting all your JSON as a tree, which gave us paths, and we are indexing it as a graph. So when you are querying the index of Barrel, you are just querying a graph, literally. And you can filter by path, get a portion of path, etc. And of course, you can just say, I will ignore some path, or if I just want that to get everything corresponding to that object country, so I can create country and an index nested path, something like this. So Barrel can be embedded in your Erlang application, but it's also available as ports and nodes on which you can dialogue using HTTP or Erlang distribution, but using specific things. So in your application, Barrel acts as a local database. It can be on disk or it can be in memory. And you don't need any cache because your data is already in Barrel. So the problem to solve. The first problem to solve is the complexity of writing a database. First, a database is stateful. Or you can imagine to have a stateful database in Erlang when your processes are not sharing anything between themselves. And actually, that could be simple because since the state is in the process, you can imagine that your database could be just a process or an actor. And just consider that your database is always maintained by one process in your systems. The only issue is that the system is, of course, you are doing different queries, and each queries are returning different results. So you can't imagine to have only one process returning and keeping all the results. So you will have to find some things. And the other complexity to solve is, what are you expecting when you update your document? When you update your database, are you expecting that what you write is what you are writing at the moment, you will be able to read it immediately right after? Or you don't care, you just update your database, and sometimes you will read the data that you wrote on your database. And other stuff like other expectation like this. So the question is, why I would have to solve that, and why not doing everything? So you can say, I just want to upgrade the data, and I will read that right after, or just say, I'm update the data, and it will be sometime indexed when the node will be able to index that, and you will read that later, and listen on that change to know when it's updated also. We have some Erlang constraints. So the one that I already talked, the process doesn't share anything. How can we handle multiple writers and multiple readers at the same time? Concurrent writers, concurrent process writing to your database, concurrent readers reading also your database. How can we handle that? We have no integer atomic operation. So if you know a little how much are working database today, is to prevent locking, to remove locking, they are using atomic update on integer, doing a simple add to an integer to make sure that you have only one process thread that are actually upgrading the data. You can't do that in Erlang. You can use processes for that. This is actually a good log, but then you have more latency. And updating automatically an integer is only 0.001 millisecond, where updating a process can be 10 milliseconds. So you have more latency and you have to handle that when you are doing a database in Erlang. IO operations are slow, in quote, in Erlang, mostly because we have to pass most of the time via a process, or at least we can make sure that we can write without having to use a process. But then for your reader, you will have to query that process to get what is on the file. So until you are writing your own ifs to do the to do also, sorry, I forgot to talk about that. So this is not only slow, but you are not you are also not accessing to the low level operation on disk that you can do. Like for SSD, you can say I want to access to that part for NVMe SSD, for example. You can access to that part of the cache of the disk and do that operation first out of cache on the right and read it for directly from the cache. Stuff like this, you can't do that directly in Erlang, so you will have to write on C. So I decided first that I didn't want to care about IO operations, so why not just reusing the database that already exists, like RocksDB, LevelDB, or whatever, and abstracting everything, every access as a key value interface, which allows Barrel to use something like Postgres, or even React as a backend, or Cassandra as a backend. So it only requires that I'm able to have a key value interface on the backend, that I'm able to have another set and to be able to do batch update. So in something like LevelDB, you can write a batch atomically, and using something like Postgres, you can use a transaction to do that and other stuff. And probably if the backend doesn't work like this, we can do something like Datomic and write a simple interface, writing a tree over that database and simulating a B tree over a database, just like Datomic does. The other decision I took is we have one collection, one storage when it's about RocksDB. So when you are querying a database, you are really querying one database on the backend. Which allows stuff like just moving your hard disk to another node when you want to scale on the future. And collections are definitely small. You don't store 1 terabyte on one database, at least on one simple disk. We are generally focusing on small database, 100 gigabyte or 200 gigabyte mostly, so we are able to split and to move that data very fast from one hard disk to another hard disk. If you want to go to large database, then you have to introduce some new logic on top of that to shard the data, to partition data. Something that will be available also later in the next version of Parallel. And I already said that. So we are storing documents in Barrel. I think it has a map in Erlang and a JSON in other things. With that document, we are storing a revision tree. Most of the databases are using vector clock to make sure you are able to handle concurrent updates and replicate concurrent updates. Basically, a vector clock is here to make sure that we are able to recover the order in which you did your updates. So we are able to apply the update in order on another node. But rather than using vector clock, which are very hard to handle in true P2P worlds, because to resolve the conflicts in using vector clock, you have to dialogue between the nodes. So the two nodes have to be online at the same time. Using a tree, like a revision tree, and this is described in the Ash Histories paper, on which you have the link there. Using a tree, we are able also to do that, to find causality of the update, the time when the updates were done. So for example, we take that example. We are creating first the documents, which give us a first revision. So number one, because we are on the level one on the tree, and this is the hash of your document. Then you are doing a second revision on one node, which has for that revision a different hash. On a second node, somewhere is at some point you replicated that document on another node. You have a concurrent update happening, and it gave us a second revision. And you have a third node that is also updating at the same time that document. So we mean now we have three branch on that tree. Then the two nodes are replicating between themselves, continue to update. You can see here that we have replicated that things here. But because we had another update there, this update will be the winner. We have we are doing convergence. We are converging things. We are basically the longest branch always win by per default in the revision tree. Just like in the blockchain, you have the longest branch keeping the transaction that is winning by per default. And if you want to solve the conflict, then you have to go back in the tree. And the advantage is compared to a vector clocks is that since you have that tree of causality there, you can already solve that. If you want to solve the conflict, just create another revision that will record the deletion of that branch. Do the same for the other branch that you don't want to keep. And do a new update on the new branch. So so this branch will always win because the other has been marked as deleted. Not sure I was clear. The other decision, so this allows us, this allows us to replicate the document in a master way, so you can edit your notes, you can edit your document, put your update of your document, even disconnected. The causality is always kept. And when you connect the next time, you can just replicate the trees and the conflict will be resolved like this. We have two modes of indexing, lazy and consistent. That's a decision I took. Lazy, every document is indexed asynchronously. So a process is listening on change and index them. If there are room on the machine, if there are enough memory, if there are enough disk. If not, it will just wait that the machine become quiet to index. And the other mode, and which is the default, is the consistent mode. So each time you put an update, it will be indexed immediately, and you already have access that to in the index. And the index supports different basic operation. You can map over all the documents, over all the document indexed, yeah, on a path. You can then filter the content of your document, and you can chain operation to do something like join or union. This is very, very basic, and then we can imagine any DSL on top of that to do that, even SQL things or GraphQL or whatever. So how it's done in Erlang? So like I said, I'm using RocksDB for the storage, and for that I wrote a binding. So it started as a fork of LevelDB using a custom pool of threads to handle the concurrency. So we are sure to not block the schedulers. But then since the version 19, I think, or 18, you have .inif in Erlang, so we have decided to rewrite that using .inifs because it removes all the complexity that you can have using your own pool of threads in NIFs, and also because that pool of threads that you are launching inside your NIF can also conflict with the scheduler sometimes. So sometimes it could happen that you are blocking your machine because the both pool, both the scheduler and the pool were conflicting on the update, stuff like this. And so the new bindings of Erlang RocksDB is using is written as a NIF and can be used for the memory storage. We don't use the ETS to store in memory. We just use RocksDB, and it is also optimized for SSD support. And you can get that on GitLab. So like I said, one database is one storage on a disk. and you can have many storage on one barrel nodes. You can start many storage, and the supervision is very simple. So you have the main barrel supervisor, a database supervisor that supervises any database process launch, and a store process that makes sure that you can create, delete, close the database without having conflicts, concurrency issue, etc. It basically serializes the operation to create and delete database, which prevents some risk condition that happened recently in Babel, where sometimes we were deleting a database and the other part of the system didn't know that the database was deleted, trying to do some things and crashing, of course, because trying to open a deleted database or to delete while creating a database is, of course, creating some issues. The other thing is, so we have that database process that is handling that is maintaining the NIF resource, and on which we are doing every write. So we are all the writes are done for now on one process outside the app. So you have an option in your process when you span a new process. You can say that you don't want to keep the message in the main app of the process, which remove them from the garbage collection. So if you have a lot of events waiting for an update, for example, then they won't be garbage collected, or they won't prevent garbage collected, or they won't trigger any spike in the VM that can crash your full machine because of too much CPU usage. So all the writes for now are queued in the main DB process. When a document arrives, we modify it a little. So we are making sure that your document, whatever the machine on which it arrives, is always in order, because there is no, the order is not kept in JSON protocol, and the order of your properties in the document is not kept also in the map, in the long maps. So we need to have a way to make sure that when you hash a document, it's always the same hash, whatever the machine on which it happened. So we are doing a canonical version of the document to be indexed and creating the revision. And once the update happened, the state is shared between the other processes via an ETS table that is used for now. So we so every reader will are just accessing that ETS table concurrently without any issue and without any problem to any concurrency problem. The problem with that design is we have one process getting all updates, all events, etc. So how do we prevent delete jobs? Because we have a lot of people waiting, so it prevents any updates. And the first time in the initial design, we were only able to do 40 operations per second, which wasn't that fast. It's actually what does CouchDB, but it's very not fast. So how do we speed that? The first thing and very cool thing that we have in message in Erlang message is we can select receive, so we can prioritize some message that arrives. We keep them and we use them first, which allows us to group the operations. So if you have a document, the same document updated three times, we are collecting that three concurrent updates at the same time, merging the update, and make sure we can return the conflict immediately and just store the version we want to. That change allowed us to go from 40 operation per requests per second to 1,000 requests per second on a very small node, which is 4 gigabytes and 2 core, which is one of the smallest nodes that you can also have on Amazon services, etc. Yes, so when the write is done, then we write the state in the database. We can do two queries on the storage without any indexing. You can create document by IDs, you can fold document by IDs, and you can get all the changes in the database from the start, from a second. Each time you update, we are storing seconds for each update of the documents locally. And then you can queries for the change. And this is done very in parallel in your database, since every reader access to ETS first to get the last state of the database, and then query that database in their own processes without blocking first. Everything happened on the reader process. What is coming anyway? So we are introducing some back pressure because having multiprocessing reading at the same time, even ETS or on the database, is creating a lot of pressure, increasing the memory usage and the CPU usage. So we are ditching. I am ditching the ETS to share the state, and rather it will use a pool of processes, just like Orléans does for the in Microsoft Word for the grain system. So we have when the writer will update the database, it will send the state to a pool of readers processes that will keep a view of that database, and each query that wants to read that database will access to that pool of process at some point, which allows us to have a natural back pressure across the pool of systems. And on the right, we are also there are two tests that are actually running and that will be part of the next release. One is I'm testing to dispatch the write operation across a pool of writer process. So because the atomicity can happen on the documents, we know that each document is uniquely updated. We can have then have some process taking part of that merge operation for the write process. And the complexity of that is how do you make an atomic update if you want to update multi-document at once to make something like a simple transaction, to make sure that you can update the balance and your account at the same time, for example. Then I'm using a system, basing the system on something called acyclic transaction. So you have your pool of process on which you make sure that every write is done all for one document is always done on one on the same process. And the question is, what happens if you have a conflict? Then you need to go back forward in your pool and cancel the operation and continue the other one. And this is all the principle that is put in that dispatching of write on different process. I'm not sure about the result because performance-wise, okay, you were removing that serialization in one process. But on the other hand, you have to take care if your database is using a lot of if you used to have a lot of conflicts on your database because a lot of people are updating the same document at the same times, then that system won't be performant at all. So you need to have a choice to go back to the other system because just serializing on one queue is faster in that case. And the other stuff that I'm testing that will also be part of the experimental of the next release is optimistic write. So instead of going in one process blocking everything, I'm just trying to update that document directly in the process and retry until it works. This is just like our work STM in Clojure. So if some of you are doing Clojure, you have the reference on the atom, and you can update your atoms multiple times. You can have concurrent update of your atoms, and what it does is trying a version of the atom at that time. It tries to update it, and if it's conflicts, meaning the atom has been updated in between, it retry until a number of times. And this is what will be also available in Barrel in its release coming next week. You have back pressure introduced. We are short-circuiting the system. If we can't accept much more writes because the memory is used, because the CPU is used, or because the system detected that your requests are starting to be slow, then we are refusing any other update on the systems. It's better than just crashing. Indexing process is very simple. Once we analyze the documents and extracted the path from the document, compared to the older version to know which path has been deleted, which part of your document has been deleted, and which part of your document has been updated, we are appending that to the indexer. We never go back, we never go read in the past, to remove another this old path. We just recording that deletion and recording that update operation on the path for that document, and that's all. So it's getting very fast, and most is done first in memory, and then flush it to the disk very fast. Of course, everything is logged first on the disk. So we can, if something crash in between, then the write will be done again on the next restart. So this is done inside the DB process for consistent write. And for the lazy indexing, we are another process, listening on DB updates. And we are not using gnven, just a gen server. And when an update happens, then it go back in the change logs, get that change, compare, do the analyze part, and store it on disk asynchronously. We have different index policies that allows you to index only part of the segments you want to. Saying, for example, if you have a part of your JSON that you know that is a user object, and you just want to get that user object each time, then you just say to the indexer, index me a hash of that user object, and I will compare that to what you give me when you create that. The replication is done over two transport, over HTTP, using COBOL 2. So hopefully we will be also to do that using HTTP 2. This is the default transport actually with coming WebSocket. And a new transport has been just added over TCP. So this is just like Erlang distribution, except that we wanted something that we are able to proxy using Nginx or any other proxy available. So you can't do that really with EPMD because you need to dialogue with EPMD or bypass EPMD for the discovery. And then it's also quite difficult to allow that, to prioritize, because you, if some of you are using Erlang distribution, sometimes on the busy node, you will get a busy message from that node because Erlang is starting to prioritize the system message, making sure that he can send the ping to the other nodes or stuff like this. So you will get a busy message. Or if you also run Nesia on the same node, then Nesia will take a lot of message passing between nodes. So that allows you to launch a new TCP port, or any TCP port actually, one for the write and at least two for the read. And doing just RPC, Erlang RPC over TCP, just like usual. And it's TCP transport is the default in the embedded mode. So we remove that HTTP communication when you embed by default in your application, so it doesn't conflict if you are using COBOL 1 or LE or Mocky Web or any other things. The important things I quite forgot is, that's okay, we are writing the database, and we saw at the beginning we have some issue, some latency issue, we saw that the write was slow, etc., but we wasn't able to know from where it was happening. We didn't instrument at all that node. So instrumentation is the key of a distribution system, because it allows us to watch any parts of your nodes and to understand what is happening actually. So the first version, because we were in a hurry, we didn't try. We try to just use a static client sending to an EDP endpoint and doing something like what is done actually in process one in Jeopardy by default. We were just panning a process each time, sending a UDP message, closing the UDP port. The problem with that is that we were crashing the node, not because of the node were slow or whatever, but because we were spanning too much processes, so at some point it was running out of processes and crashing, or we were opening too much UDP port, and at some point we were running out of file descriptor and we were crashing. So we improved that by introducing a process sending asynchronously the message, so we were just updating a counter and from time to time sending that over UDP. It was better, but then the question came, how to make that generic, how to make that easier for anyone so you can use your own solution, etc. And we first started by adding some hooks inside the database, not events, etc. Hooks is really run in the process and can run in the process. And for that, I'm using my library, which is hooks, which is compiling modules. It doesn't use ETS, etc. It's just compiling on-the-flight functions that is available in your VM. So it's using the memory app and it's shared without any locking. We have introduced some hooks, and on that hooks, we added, if you see at the bottom, we created, for example, a barrel start transaction hooks. That is launched at the beginning of the transaction, adding some time to the process and counting there in Prometheus because it's a Prometheus plugin, and counting that, incrementing that transaction counter. And because we have hooks, we are able to handle anything. So we are able to handle Prometheus, and we have also Wombat support in the enterprise version. So we are able to do that, and we have also in work in progress. We have also an internal metric system, so it's mostly used for the back pressure, because we want something more faster without any lock at all, without using ETS or whatever. So this is an experimental process using some C++ things, using floats, but we will remove the floats usage that is actually a problem, because try to update a float atomically, it's very hard. You need to do some retry to make sure that you are incrementing your floats. So we just use integer for, and this is really what we just need for our internal metric systems. But you can see the work in progress on that GitLab. And I quite finished. So on the roadmap, there is a release coming next week. It was supposed to happen on Monday, but apparently some people moved, some rendezvous. And so we have that new release that includes everything that we saw today, including the performance improvement in the writer, in the back pressure in the reader, etc. I want to add more documentation. So there are some documentation now that will be released. But the goal is, I'm very jealous from what did Jiri for the GraphQL documentation. So I want to have a good documentation so any user can use it and develop over that. We have something that is coming that month, our atomic updates. So you will be able to send some function to your node to do some kind of transaction. So if you want to design your own transaction system and query internally the node, you will be able to do that by sending a Lua function to the node, and also enrich the query engine. So we have a query engine based on GraphQL that is coming. So, and voila, if you have some questions. So in Erlang, you have the concept of selective receive. So each message that happens, you can have some kind of pattern matching. And when you first match in your receive, you can match first one message, one pattern. And if you just match that one, it will be prioritized by Erlang. This is how we are doing that prioritization. And then going back further in the loops, for the other update that I want to take care of later. So if I have a batch already came to my systems, I'm first prioritizing the ID that I already have collected, and then going to the rest and merging that part. for the using the RocksDB backend, everything is appended to logs. And for the other backend, depending on the backend, we can add or not a wall, mostly logging first and writing later. But most of the backend already have that. Could be Postgres or Cassandra. They already logs for us the data. Yeah. Thank you.